Where do I look? Are we looking here? Are we looking there? Where do I look?
We are looking at the camera. I mean, we're looking at each other, technically.
I think I should change my parting. 1 second.
But I'm a little confused.
What do you think? This parting? Yeah, no?
Better than the center one. This is not center, right?
No. I think I should also put the computer. No, no? You know, suddenly I don't like anything.
Yeah, but I know what you mean. Second podcast. Not surprised that happened to us.
Especially with me.
Your phone crashed, my hard disk crashed. Now we're here. What have you been up to?
Wow. I've been very busy working, making deadlines, writing. That's about it. My life is in like a permanent phase of Mercury retrograde.
I know.
How did I get here? Why am I born? Except for my little white fluffy dog, I don't really like anything or anyone. Wow. Whatever it is, it's the Mercury. It's just been like Mercury after Mercury after Mercury. Like, what's up with Mercury, man?
Are your crystals working?
Are my pimples? My crystals have been abandoned in a corner. They play with my plants now. That's about it.
When you went for that random hipster party in Brooklyn.
It wasn't random hipster, those were our friends.
Those were your friends. I was just tagging along and you got a Facebook invite to a party or something like that.
No, my friend Emma invited me to a party.
Right.
One of us was going through something strange.
I wonder who that
as,
is.
As always.
Yeah.
And I remember you very clearly telling me, like, checking your partner's phone.
Oh God, no.
I remember this advice that you gave me and I'll never forget it because it was words of wisdom. Checking your partner's phone is like putting a finger up your ass and smelling it. And I'm like, Shreya, why would you tell me this?
I don't know what the that was.
I don't know why I was giving you advice. Like, I think I was a little bit of a mama bear in that situation, even though you were just like...
You were. You really took care of me through that week.
But we had fun. I think it wasn't like sad or anything. It was more like...
Mellow? No. What was it? What's the word? Heartbroken? No. For some reason, I'm always heartbroken in New York. Always. I see a tree at Prospect Park and permanent state of...
The highlight of that day was that we went for a random hipster party. It was like out of a movie, out of a scene from Girls or something. I remember there was like a projector that had surfing videos on one wall.
Very hipster.
There was someone playing on the piano. There was a random dog in the corner. People were smoking. There was a bowl of punch. And there was this guy who obviously was very enamored by Megha and he kept hitting on her the entire night.
He wasn't in a subtle way.
Very polite, but Megha obviously, she didn't know what to do.
I was like, okay, meet my friend Shreya. I remember speaking to him only because he had the lovely dog, which is important.
He had a motorbike and he had a penthouse and he seemed super cool.
Yeah. Where is he now? And he was very handsome and he was a doctor of some sorts, right? Saved lives. Or was he a fireman?
I don't think he was a fireman.
Shreya, let's talk about the fact that we released the film this year, you and me.
Let's talk about that.
Yeah. About how I met you as a 15-year-old at a Christmas party, at Mallika's Christmas party, and you were a total noob, and so was I. But I was taking photographs, and you were very enchanted by my camera. We spoke about Saturday Night Live, and then we spoke about Maya Rudolph, Superbad, and Knocked Up. Yeah, and then we started hanging out, and it didn't seem creepy at all that like older person is hanging out with a 15-year-old. You sent me a lot of your videos, which I really loved at that point of time. I was like, this is the most original underground work coming out of India right now. It was so like authentic and radically sweet. It had no suffering attached to it, and that's something in particular I loved about your work. It was exactly the way you are.
I remember going over to Megha's house and intimidated by the prospect of wanting to talk to me about something, some kind of story that they want to write.
We, Shiv and me, actually only wanted to work with you because you were 16. For the first time in India that a teenager has written a film about teenagers, and that's why it gets it right.
Give me
kind of body of work I have, I never expected a film like What Are the Odds, which is, you know, a mumblecore musical in a way, to even find its way to a mainstream, and it did. So I was always very excited about it. It's very important for your team to not be strangers to you. I mean, the kind of film I make, it's not a professional team that I can rely on. They have to understand me emotionally. I really want to talk about is the fact that eccentric people aren't understood well enough. That I am eccentric, and people find that very puzzling. And it shouldn't. I mean, there should be space for everyone. People are like constantly calling you quirky and this and that, and I'm like, what's quirky, man? I don't understand it.
Like, constant question, is this voice too American sounding?
If it is American sounding, there's nothing wrong with the fact that a lot of us grew up watching populist American culture because it was available to us easily. Like, I'm not going to deny the influence of Tina Fey or Paul Thomas Anderson or Harmony Korine in my life, because these were things that were easily accessible to me at that point of time. I don't understand why it's looked down upon. Like, for example, my partner is American, also a filmmaker, and he had one of the biggest influences in my life. So, you know, these are our personal lives. And our personal lives are very reflective of the choices we make as artists as well. I think I also needed this alone time. And you know, Shreya, yeah, people like you and me are always in a state of lockdown anyway, you know, so we are nesters. It's not like we like getting out, being social. We don't love having friends or anything like that. I mean, we're okay. We're like, huh, theek hai. There's been a certain discipline to my life where I go cycling, I do boxing. I also end up eating a lot of dessert because I learned how to order things on Zomato and Swiggy.
There's no reason to not have cake. Like, as an adult, like, you don't need to have a birthday to have cake. So you can just order cake whenever you want, which is insane.
Which is what I do. You know, I put on 8 kilos through the lockdown, and I never realized it till the chair I'm sitting on actually
what
collapsed.
Crap?
And
you look like the same. Now I've been watching Jameela Jamil, who I think you look like. Yeah, she talks about like body positivity and how weight has nothing to do with the.
Yeah, that's because she's also like super skinny. Ask a fat person about body positivity. And there's nothing I have, like, I love Jameela. And the fact is that, you know, not only is she talking about body positivity, but she's also talking about bulimia, anorexia. Nobody talks about eating disorders. And, you know, it's really weird because all of us unconsciously are permanently going through an eating disorder at any given point of time in life. I went through a formal eating disorder when I was a kid because I was so fat. There was so much pressure to look a certain way. And then the minute you lose all that baby fat, you really kind of thrive on your eating disorder. It becomes an obsessive compulsive disorder.
Because it's like you're getting these positive affirmations that people find you more attractive now because you're
attractive. Because I was such a weirdo and I've been called a weirdo all my life, it just made sense. I'm like, if I'm weird, I will balance it out by looking good. At least I'll be a good looking weirdo.
It's so crazy that like almost everyone I talk to has some kind of body image issue. That's like deep rooted. And it's so sad.
It is deep.
But I also feel like you can't be lying. People talk like if you accept your body, things will be fine. I think it's easier said than done. It's not like a linear path. You're gonna have to go this way to finally accept your body.
Yeah, I think it's easier to reject your body than accept your body.
I was gonna ask you about the money thing, because have you always felt the shame around asking for money?
I have become more materialistic as a person now. So my relationship with money is a lot more dependent. Like, I like buying a certain kind of product. I mean, and I don't shy away from the fact, you know, I know the world is heading towards non-materialism and I get that, but I'm heading the exact opposite way. Like, if I go to a Tashkin bookstore, I want to buy all the books. If I go to a good camera store, I want to buy the Leica, you know. I want things that I like and that costs money.
Yeah.
So I really want to change that about the system, because when you're kids, you never get paid. It's like they're doing you a favor. It's been so exploitative as a culture. We go to offices that have like Nespresso coffee machines and huge gardens, and then they can't afford to pay you a writer fee of 50,000 rupees.
And then you feel kind of lousy to like even ask for it.
And this was then. Now I'm very blatant. Now I'm like, you owe me money. and yeah. I won't do this if you don't. And otherwise, I'll do it as a favor for you. But if you're hiring me as a professional, I see to it that I get paid.
And how crazy and revolutionary does that idea have to be? Because you're putting in time and effort. You're working for that person.
So it's an exchange of ideas. That person is dependent on my work. They live in like these lovely lush apartments with Nespresso machines. I'm stuck to the Nespresso machine. I think sitcoms have ruined the idea of friendships. Because now friendships basically just means hanging around in groups and cliques. It's just such a difficult concept to fucking deal with anymore. Just leave me alone, man. I don't want to be your friend.
Because it's a high-pressure situation that usually presents itself.
Yeah, but people romanticize friendship too much. Like, there's too much of cause-effect when it comes to friendships. And I'm like, listen, I don't even like that word. It's just we are human beings. There are two people. We're in a relationship. And it should be like that. What is friendship? Like, that's what two-year-olds do, man. Okay, fine. Be fucking friends. General advice I would give to be authentic to the person you are. And the earlier you start practicing that, the easier life gets. I would recommend The Vegetarian by Hank Aang. The movie is obviously Matthias and Maxime for me. It's the movie of the year for me. It's just so beautiful and tender. Xavier Dolan has turned out to be astonishingly like one of the bravest filmmakers I have come across. Every time I see a picture of Xavier Dolan on the Instagram, I'm like, oh my God, man. Man, I just want to hang out with him. Like, you know.
Yeah.
Just since we've hung out, I kind of miss our dates. You remember when you learned how to drive and you called me saying that I want to surprise you, and you came down in a car and you took me for a drive. And then we listened to that song by what's her name? Joanna Newsom.
You love Joanna. You made me. Yeah.
I have a very good memory.
Because that was such a sweet moment. I remember, Shrey, we have to, like, I saw the odds at that moment when I listened to that song. And I'm like, this is the song, you know, because I wanted that as a reference song when the burial takes place. And what are the odds is about a good day.
So, congratulations.
Congratulations on all the accolades you've been getting, young Shreya.
What are the odds?
Okay, how are we signing off with this?
Signing off, just saying, there's no sign off really, but I'll just usually wave. Yeah.
No, you're supposed to say bye like this.
Time of Corona.
This sucks. I'm only doing it because you made me do it.